your mic on?
And my mic is not on. And what you'll see is this. So this is great. This is a two-dimensional image. And it turns out that there is a very involved process going from capturing light from a scene through your device and then generating the image. That's not what we're going to talk about today. We're going to assume, as most engineers do, that you're starting with this digital image on the right. So the question is, why would we even need to compress, right? Like, if we can represent images digitally and we have pixels and we can assign color values to those pixels, why do we need compression? So there are a lot of reasons. The first being, if you're a gadget geek, unlike me, because I'm not, I just got like a phone and I'm like, this is great, whatever, I'll just use it. But if you're one of those people who's like, the newest iPhone has 12 megapixel camera, and you're really excited about that, what does that mean? So 12 megapixels, let's break that down. Mega, of course, in Latin means million, so you've got 12 million pixels. Now each pixel these days is typically represented using three colors. Red, green, and blue. And each pixel value in each color channel will use 1 byte of information. So 3 bytes per pixel and 1 million bytes per image. Each image could use up to 36 megabytes of storage. Does that jive with what you know, right? Like, first off, what is Gmail's attachment limit? 25 megabytes. How often do you attach, like, an entire photo album, not entire, but like 5 to 10 images on an email? Quite often, right? So something's going on here. So we could, depending on what you do, you could actually break down the 36 megabytes down to 18 megabytes using, you can convert to a different color space. But you're still in like the really large megabyte range. And this means that if you want to upload, say, a very simple photo album of only 100 photos, it could require up to 1.8 gigs. That does not seem practical. So this is why compression is essential. And the reality is that these days, we typically compress almost everything, and in order to access something, we will decompress it. So for example, when you set up a new phone, this is a screenshot from my phone. You guys might have noticed, first thing you do with an Android is Android says, how do you want to store your images? Can I upload them to the cloud? And you say, yes, of course, that's a great idea. I'd like to automatically back up everything. But then you might notice it says, do you want to upload something called original or high quality? Turns out high quality is a euphemism for I'm compressing the crap out of your image because we don't want to use as much space. I have a promotion because I got my pixel at a certain time, so I get to use original up until 2021. And to be quite frank, after 2021, I will probably keep doing, I will probably switch down to high quality because I don't want to have to pay like $4 in Google Drive Store per month instead of $2. I'm guessing some of you also make this trade-off. but this is what's going on, right? Like our lives, data is being compressed sort of below the surface, and it's become so ubiquitous that if you're like me, you just sort of had no idea until hopefully today. So another good example is, do you guys remember when Facebook also asked you, do you want to upload in high quality versus original? So you might have noticed actually, now Facebook just defaults to compression. You cannot actually select, I don't think you can upload images originally, the original image, and in fact, there's even a very helpful page like, how do I get the best out of my Facebook images, because I'm noticing that you're doing crappy stuff to it. So yeah, clearly compression is completely necessary in this day and age. So let's set the stage first. If you've ever talked to me, I'm one of Saki's unusual students in that I'm really into like history and story, so I'm going to like spend 10 minutes on history. Okay, so let's start with some information theory history. As you guys all know, the field started in 1949 when Claude Shannon published one paper. You probably say this all in your sleep now, and that paper is of course called A Mathematical Theory of Communication. Fast forward only 2 years, and then the whiz kid Huffman designed the Huffman code that you are all now very familiar with through the paper, A Method for Construction of Minimum Redundancy. The reason why I'm mentioning Huffman codes and some other codes is we'll come back to them later because they're very important when it comes to practical compression. So another one of these is Lovell Ziv. Turns out you have to wait 26 years for that to happen, but in 1977, Lovell and Ziv published LV77, which I believe you went over in class, right? Okay, good. So just keep that in mind. In 1984, some guy named Terry Welch, not some guy, I'm sorry, that's horrible. Terry Welch, very important person, published an algorithm called LZW, which stands for Lundell, Ziv, and Welch. And it was basically a variant of LV77 that we'll examine in closer detail. Okay, great. So this is sort of the theoretical timeline that I want you to keep in mind. It's only like 40-ish years, not too much. And actually, like surprisingly, depending on how you want to look at it, I don't know, I view 1984 surprisingly old, even though I was born not too long after that. But the point is, okay, so that's the theoretical timeline. While the theorists are theorizing, something else very exciting is happening, this thing called computers. So in 1965, two computers were connected for the first time via dial-up phone line. Is this exciting to you? No. Do you guys even know what dial-up is? Yeah. Okay, yeah, talking to the dial-up. Oh gosh, this is great. Like, when I think of middle school, my middle school is like excitedly or checking to make sure no one's on the phone, starting the dial-up, hearing that stupid sound, logging on to AIM, seeing what everyone's away message is, right? Like, did you guys do this? No? Okay. This happened not too long ago. These days now we have wireless, we have Wi-Fi, and we have high-speed internet, so none of that is an issue. But if we go all the way back to 1965, this was the first time that two computers could actually be connected. And if we look at the timeline, it's only 10 years after Huffman is doing his thing. So it's kind of cool to look at how computers are developing with theory. So if we fast forward a little bit to 1969, the first message is sent over something called ARPANET. Let me tell you a bit about ARPANET. ARPA stands for the Advanced Research Projects Agency. So they want a network, so hence the name ARPANET. ARPANET actually set the stage for what would become the modern internet today. And it was a collaboration between a bunch of science research labs, and they're all like, well, we're doing really exciting science, we're doing it with these really cool computers, but it would be really great if we could talk to each other more often, right? Like if I'm in UCLA and Siobhan's in Utah and we want to exchange data or we want to even send each other a message, we have to take the phone, we have to text stuff. This is very inefficient. So, In 1969, the first four computers were set up on ARPANET. One was in UCLA, one was here at SRI, Stanford Research Institute in Menlo Park. Anyone been to it? Oh, okay. Yeah, you have talking heads. It's like literally 5 minutes from my house. It looks like the 60s, and this is why. there was one at UCSB and one at the University of Utah School of Computing. This was very exciting. So now we're starting to see the internet come into shape. And this is exciting, and also the funny thing is that the first message that was sent out in 1969 was the word login. Someone sent the text word login to someone else a across the country. Well, I guess across a couple of states, and there was like lots of cheering. The funny thing was that the initial message was actually just L-O, and then the system crashed. So technically, the very first text ever sent was L-O, the first successful one was logged in, and that happened in October 1969. Okay, so let's keep moving on. So only 3 years later, as I said, these scientists want to communicate with each other, so they developed this thing called email. Email is great. Now everyone has an email. Now apparently parents are signing up their unborn children for legacy accounts so that when they grow up, they can, you know, state their claim on their email account so that they're not like Irena, you know, 2021.June, whatever, sparkles, because that would be annoying. Anyway, the point is that like email is the same, but it started in 1972. And the reason why I want to point out email is because in addition to the internet being a place of setting up information via a website and exchanging it, email is the other great platform where you can send information directly. And this is another place where, of course, we know now we send pictures and why image compression is useful. So anyway, in 1991, Tim Berners-Lee releases the very first web browser called the World Wide Web. And the very first web page that was ever created was one for CERN, which is where he was working at the time. Just a fun fact, I guess. All right, so now we're going to move on to, we're going to add a blue set to the timeline, and blue is going to be history of digital images, kind of. That's a lie, because I'm clearly not talking about the history of digital image creation, which is its own very cool Wikipedia page, so check that out if you're interested. But for our intents and purposes, the most important thing to think about is in 1986, a bunch of people who were working in communication were looking around and they're like, oh wow, we're starting to have this thing called the internet, we have email, we want to send and exchange information. Let's think about how they could do this better. So in 1986, a very special group convened called the Joint Photographic Experts Group. And it is no mistake that JPEG, that, you know, if you spell that out, spells JPEG, and everyone knows that JPEG is a popular file format today. Except they didn't get their act into gear for a few years. In the meantime, in 1987, the JIT format was invented, and JIT is going to be one of the things we talk about. So that's a thing that happened only a year later. Finally, in 1982, the JPEG group gets its act together and releases their first standard called JPEG. And we're also going to talk about that. Now, in 1995, something happened that's unfortunate, and depending on who you talk to, it happened and sort of threw the field into an uproar and subsequently launched new technological development, which sometimes change does. So in 1995, so actually in 1984, when LBW was published by Terry Welsh, he immediately patented it because it was a good idea. But then in 1995, the company he was working for suddenly decided that they wanted to start charging royalties for it. Patents are one thing, charging money for it is another thing. A lot of engineers got hot under the collar and they were pissed about that. And so in 1996, a group got together and invented a file format called Ping. So Ping is directly sort of a direct response to something that happened in patent law. Oh, and I should mention, sorry, LZW in the LZW was developed in 1984. We see how the internet has been happening sort of at the same time. GIF is directly based on LZW, and we'll see how that happens. So that's why Ping was a direct response to GIF. So, fun fact. And since then, like, it's been kind of quiet on the Western front. We'll get into details, and I hope I'm not offending any diehard image compression people out there, but like, it's, you know, JPEG has sort of been the ruler for the last 30-ish years, right? Like, I can't think of a time I haven't reached for a JPEG or a Ping. And the only time I reach for GIF is when I want to make a meme. And I'm guessing you guys do too. So for our intents and purposes, it's kind of quiet from 1996 until last year, when these people at a place called Stanford started thinking about how humans might inspire image compression. So we're going to talk about all of this in more detail. But before we do that, I just want to set up vocabulary and problem setting, because that's what we like to do in this class, the problem setting and vocabulary. So starting from left to right, we have an original image, which of course is a bitmap. And a bitmap, very simply, is a map of colored bits. So that's very intuitive. It's what we think of when we think of an image. Now the thing is, we can send that image through something called an encoder, which you guys are probably pretty familiar with. And the job of an encoder is to take a bitmap and to encode it in a clever way so that the file in the end can be compressed into, sorry, the file can be represented using a stream of bits or bytes, and in general we want that file size to be much smaller than the original bitmap. That's a golden encoder. Now, if you want to see what is in an encoded file, you use a decoder, and you can send it to the decoder. The job of a decoder is to perform what the encoder did in exact reverse. This is sort of a very important part of practical compression. We have the assumption that the encoder and decoder are identical, but they operate in reverse, so that any bit you put in, you will get some representation, and then you'll get the exact same thing out every time. That makes sense? I hope I interpreted that correctly, but that's sort of the basics of encoding and decoding. And then, of course, after you send a compressed bit stream through a decoder, you end up with a reconstructed image, which is another bitmap, which is something you can parse with your eyes. It's not crazy binary, it's just a file. And depending on the sort of compressor you use, either that reconstructed image will be identical to the original one, or it will be different, and we'll talk about that. So, to be clear, when we talk about attaching images in emails and uploading to Google Drive, what we're attaching and uploading is not the bitmap, right? We're not, I know that when you drag and drop something into Gmail, it looks like you're popping in a picture. You're not. What you're doing is you're sending a compressed bitstream so that when your friend receives it, his or her computer will do the exact same thing, decompress it in the same way, and give you a bitmap. Does that make sense? Okay. And I'm sorry if you guys already knew this, but like, I just didn't know the details of it, and I thought it would be good to just like emphasize that point, that what we're slinging around are these compressed bitstreams. All right, so as you guys know, there are two kinds of compression. There's lossy and lossless, and I believe in general this class sticks to lossy. Sorry, lossless more, you know. Both? Okay, then there's rate distortion. Right, okay. But when it comes to the algorithms that you know and love, like LD77, Hoffman encoding, those are all lossless compression techniques, which means that what you're doing is you're taking information in one form and you're representing it in a more efficient way, but when you reverse that process, you're going to get identical information back. In image compression, this corresponds to two of the many file formats, GIF and PNG, and I'm going to go over some of the details for those formats. And in terms of lossy compression, we're going to talk about JPEG. And we're also going to talk about human compression, because the compression system that the humans, these very cool humans that we'll talk about, it is a lossy method. All right, so, okay, any questions so far about history, setup? Yeah, okay, all right, cool. We're going to dive into GIF. Yay, who likes GIFs? Who uses them to communicate? They're like surprisingly good for expressing oneself when, and I don't know what my tool bar just popped up, whatever. Okay, so GIF. Let's talk about the basics of GIF. Do you guys know like why GIF is useful? Why it was created? No? Perfect. Me neither. I mean, I didn't, and I do now, and I'll tell you why. So the basics. It stands for Graphics Interchange Format. It was one of the earliest developed image compression algorithms, like I mentioned. It was developed in 1987. I'm guessing that only 3 or 4 people in this room were alive then, so that's cool. It's been a while. It's also limited to 8-bit color space. So each GIF, that means that each GIF image will contain, can contain up to 256 colors. And this is one reason why GIF is so limited, and one reason why most people don't use it except to send each other funny animated reactions, as opposed to something like JPEG that can handle 24-bit RGB color space. Like I mentioned, it uniquely supports animations. PNG doesn't, JPEG doesn't, most don't. So the meat of it, and what I want to discuss in this class, is that it's based on LDW Lempel-Ziff-Welch, which you guys haven't seen, and we're going to walk through. So Lempel-Ziff-Welch was published in 1984 by Terry Welch in IEEE Computer, and this is just a very simple pseudocode for how it works. So you always assume that you have some, so you have some sort of input string. Right now we're assuming single character, and you initialize a table to contain all the single character strings. So what this means is we're going to start with the simplest possible code words, which are going to be the individual characters, and we'll walk through the example soon. So, but I'm just going to read through the pseudocode. The next thing you do is you read the first input character, and you create a prefix string omega, and then you iterate through a bunch of, you recurse through, not recurse, iterate, you just repeat through these steps. So what you do is you read the next input character k. If no such k exists, then you, oh, just kidding. If no such k exists, then you're done. Sorry, if there's no more input, you're done. Skip that step. If omega k exists in the string table, then what you can do is assign, like keep that in memory, in a buffer, I think is the right word, and then you repeat your setup. If that code is not in your table, you will add it. You will first off, you'll output your current symbol. You will add the new string to your string table. Then you'll keep that new string in your memory, and then you will repeat. And probably none of this made sense, so let's walk through an example. So, I know that this is about image compression, but we're going to do a text-based example first because that's easy. So let's say we have this string of 17 characters, A, B, A, B, C, D, whatever, I'm not going to read all of it. What you do, you start with an initial string table or dictionary. So here we have my initial string is composed only of A, B, and C characters. So we initialize a dictionary where index 1 corresponds to A, index 2 corresponds to B, 3 to C, etc. So in reality, of course, it would be annoying to have to send this dictionary every time. So most encoders and decoders assume some sort of starting set. So typically, for instance, if you're sending text, it would be the set of all ASCII characters. This is easy. Okay, and this is the compression process. And let's do this on the board because you have the answer here, but it's probably nice to see it done. Alright, so the string is, again, A, B, A, B, C, B, A, B, and then 6, A. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'm getting compressed. Okay, so what we start with is some sort of initial dictionary. And it has an index value, and it has a character. One would be A, two would be B, and three would be C. Okay, so that's what we're starting with. In step one, we're gonna read in an A. We check, is A in our initial dictionary? Yes, it is. Great, we're actually gonna do nothing. And actually before I, let me also set up a table. I'm gonna set up that table on the board. So let's do input character. Let's do, is it in the string table? Well, we're gonna do that verbally. Okay, this is the output, and also omega. All right, things to keep in mind. Okay, so our first input character was A, and omega, there's no omega K because there was no previous string, so don't worry about this field. There's no output either according to the algorithm. And so now, nothing really happened. This was K, so now omega is K because A was in the dictionary. Next step. Next input character is B. So now omega k is A, which is the previous omega, previous character omega, and k is A, k is B now, so we've got AB. And is AB in this table? No, it is not. So we're going to do two things. We're going to output this character. We're going to output the previous character, so put in A. And we're going to add AB to our table. So we're now adding index 4 for new entry, AB. Okay? And since AB was not in our table, omega K will just be the previous character, E. Okay. Next up, we have another A. Is A in the table? Yes, it is. So omega K is now going to be, it's really hard to do in person, so then A, maybe. Okay, so omega K is the previous character plus my current one, so that's BA. Is BA in the table? No. So now we add a new character to our table. And we can also add something to our output. We are coding. The point is that we're representing A's and B's using something else. So I'm sorry. The output in step one is nothing. But the output in step B is the code for B. No, the code for A. There we go. One. And then now it's the code for B. So every time you output on the line, you're outputting the previous character. So I guess a little confusing. You're sort of like keeping track of what happened previously and you're doing it now. Some people are confused. Yes, do you have a question?
Sorry, but on the board, it says 1, 2 for BA.
What? Sorry.
on that, like it says output, comma, over the home maker?
Oh, yeah. It depends. Okay, we can also do that.
Oh.
Like that. Okay. Sorry. I should not suddenly decide a different format when I'm on the board. Okay, we'll keep the format. So there we go. All right. And since this character was not in this table, now Meg is just going to be A. Okay. And I think just to match what I'm doing up there. So we've got A. This was you can think about the previous characters here. Okay. So new of the character is B this time. Of course it's in the dictionary. So omega K is now going to be A B again. Don't output anything because it's already in the dictionary. Or at least don't add to your output. And then now omega is going to be B. Is that correct?
A B.
So what's happening is that if your, what is happening? Oh yeah, okay, what's happening is if your new character is in your dictionary, your new omega is going to be omega k. If it wasn't in the dictionary, then your new omega is just k. Okay? So in this situation, our new character was is that what I did? Oh my god, it's always harder on the board.
I think you're checking whether the omega k is in the dictionary.
Yes.
And if it is in the dictionary, then you don't do anything sort of.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. And now since this was not in the dictionary, we do an output. And in this case, since AB was not in the dictionary.
AB is in.
AB is, since AB, thanks, Shubham. Since AB was in the dictionary, we're not changing our output, but omega is now something cool. So we've got C. And omega K is now AB because that was omega, and now we have C for K, so we've got ABC. That is not in our dictionary, so we're going to add an output. So we're going to encode the previous thing, which is 4 because of AB. So now I've got 1, 2, 4. And then omega in this case is going to be just C. Okay, so you can do this on your own time. but this is Lunkel's and Welch. So yes.
Do we have it in the dictionary, right?
Say it again?
Do we have ABC in the dictionary?
Yes, we do. I'm sorry. It's now 6. Okay, and I clearly spelled it out on the slide, which is much better than me mumbling in front of you in real time. Okay, so that's Lunkel's and Welch compression. Not too crazy. And of course, in this situation, this is what your final dictionary looks like. You end up with 11 possible character strings. And our encoded input started at length 17, and we ended up with 9 characters. So compression's like, okay. Of course, as if you do this for longer inputs, you get a better compression ratio. Well, sometimes. We'll get to that later. Decompression is a little more complicated. This is torn straight from Welch's paper. If you want to look at this in more detail, I'd recommend you go back to the 1984 paper. But in general, the cool thing about decompression is that, again, all you need is a starting dictionary, so the ABC dictionary. And in practice, this dictionary is well known no matter who or what is compressing. So for instance, if we start from the set of ASCII characters, everyone knows what that is. That's your initial dictionary. And then you can add to that dictionary on the fly, even during decompression. All right, so how does this translate to images? Okay, so as we know, images are two-dimensional, not one-dimensional. And in this section, by the way, I'm using everything from a very handy website called gitlib.sourcecode.net. What is an image? So let's start with a very toy example, which is a 10x10 block of pixels that can come in 3 different colors. For the purposes of the example, they were assuming that they were trying to be complete, so they wanted to include four different colors in your initial table, but in general, your initial table just depends on shared information. So here is your corresponds to white, one corresponds to red, two to blue, and three to black. So what I'm saying here is that you can take your pixels and go to something called an index tree, right? You can represent every single pixel instead of an RGB collection of bytes, you can represent it as an index. This is nice, but you still have 100 index symbols for 100 pixels. So what we need to do next is use LBW to go from an index stream to a code stream. So in GIF, in addition to your initial initial dictionary of colors and symbols, they also have two special things called, one is clear code, and that's indexed as code 4. There's also something called end of information. Those aren't super important, but it's just nice to know that GIF starts, because of the way it's encoded, like the format that they use and set up, they often have, depending on the format, they'll have additional sort of basic characters. So again, you can follow this at home, but what I want to point out is that, so you start reading it. Oh, and by the way, in GIF encoding and in actually most of these formats, you take an image and you concatenate each line so that you end up with a one-dimensional sequence. So even though I said, yes, images are 2D sequences, when we're doing encoding, we usually go back sometimes. We typically go back and encode in a one-dimensional sequence. All right, so what's happening here is basically the same thing I did here. But one thing I want to point out is that where it says not found, we add 1 and 1 as index 7. The reason why I want to point this out is in the next step, because now, oh, okay, and by the way, so in the end what you end up is with actually just this. This I think is, how many characters? It's only 36 codes. Your code stream is 36 codes long, if it was 100. That's pretty good for lossless compression. So that's the power of using LBW. But now we're not done yet, right? Because if you opened up a GIF image, you wouldn't just see a bunch of numbers. You would see a bit stream. So how do we get from a code stream to a bit stream? So the first thing is you convert the code stream into binary, of course. But GIF allows you to use something called a flexible code size, which is really nice. And we'll get into that in more detail. And this is two nice things. The first is that you can avoid limiting your max code to just 255, because if you have 8 bits, your max is 255. So if you have flexible code size, you can go beyond that. You can also avoid wasting bits for small code. As we saw in things like Huffman coding, why spend more bits when you don't need those? So that's what flexible code size is. The way flexible code size works is that as soon as you write out a new code to your string dictionary or your index dictionary equal to 2 raised to the current code size minus 1, your encoder and decoder says, aha, now I need to start reading in more bits, more bits as my code works. So, and you always start with the minimum code size. So let's do this in more detail. So we had our final code stream, which reads 4166299, et cetera, right? So our first step is convert those into binary. Foreign binary is 100, right? Because we've got 1, 2 to the squared, 0, 2 to the 1s, and 0 to the 0s. So as we can see in this first bit, okay, so first off, wait, I'm getting ahead of myself. So we have, what's our minimum code size? We have 4 different colors, white, blue, red, and black. And we also, so we have 4 different colors, so that's 2 bits. So we need 2 bits to encode those 4 colors. And we also need to reserve 1 bit for GIF's special characters, right? So we need a total of, we were starting with a minimum code size of 3. That's why, and by the way, this image is sort of funny in that the things on the bottom and the right are what's encoded first. So first we're going to encode 4 using 3 bits, so that's why we have 100. Next we have 1, which is still encoded using 3 bits, so that's 001. And then we have a 6, so that's 110. We have another 6, that's 110. But then in 2D, in byte 2D, we see that the next encoded word is 0010. And that's a 2, but why are we using 4 bits? We're doing that because we know that, if we go back a couple slides, we know that in step 6, in step 6, which is once we wrote the third character, 416, we added a code word to our code table and expanded the code table by 1 bit. Does that make sense? So the thing is, like, the way I'm presenting this is like you do LZW first and you convert from bits to bytes, et cetera, et cetera. But in reality, you're sort of doing all this at the same time on the fly. So as you're doing LZW, you're encoding into bits and keeping track of when you're adding to your table. And as soon as you add, as soon as your table memory has to increase by one bit, so too does your code word, encoded code word. Okay? So now we've got code stream to bit stream, and the bit stream is of course packaged into bytes. So ultimately what you see in your file is, and by the way, as you can obviously see, you can split up your bits across bytes, or vice versa, you split up your code words across bytes. So what you see in your code in your file, if you open up your GIF, you'll see 8C, and then you'll see 2D, and then 99, etc. And each of those bytes is actually a combination of various bit encoded code words. Okay? Does this make sense? All right. Okay, so altogether, that's just the image data. And that image data is encoded in a block of the GIF file, which also includes, you know, you don't have to start with minimum code size with no knowledge. That's always encoded in your GIF file. There's also a bunch of other important stuff, like something called a block terminator, which means that your image is over. And so this is actually the GIF file for that little 10 by 10 pixel. So as you can see, the image data is in the purple line. So we see the familiar 0 to 16. Those are, so 0 to the minimum code size, 16 is something else, and then 8C, 2D, 99, those are the bytes that we just encoded. Okay. Any file format includes other miscellaneous stuff that tells the decoder how to decode things, tells your computer what kind of file this is, might contain stuff like metadata. So if you look at the GIF file as a whole, you've got all of these colored blocks, but all we really talked about was image data. And some of this also tells you how to do animation, stuff like that. I'm not going to go into that, unfortunately, even though I had a picture of Chris Pratt looking excited. To understand that, I recommend you go back to the website. It's very comprehensive. Okay, so we're going to move on to lossless compression part 2, which is ping. So we have an idea of how GIF was started. Ping, as I mentioned earlier, stands, was developed in direct retaliation for LZW being patented or royalties levied. And so ping is a backronym? No, it is a recursive acronym that stands for Ping's Not GIF. Screw you, GIF and LZW. So engineers aren't petty at all, huh? So what else do I want to say about this? Okay, so it was developed in 1996 to be both lossless and patent-free. The cool thing is that it was adopted as an international standard in 2003. I personally think this is cool because, like, I feel like as academics, when we develop something, first off, we're not sure if other academics want to adopt it, much less if it makes it into industry. There's a whole patent process, et cetera, et cetera. The point is that, like, how do you get a bunch of people, or point is that sometimes a bunch of people agree that a certain format or a certain way of doing things is really good, and this happened for Ping. So it was adopted as an international standard. If you guys know anything about international standards organizations, consortium of a lot of countries that get together and decide on ways to transmit information between each other so that things don't get messed up. And if you notice, GIF is not an international standard. It supports both 8-bit and up to 48-bit color, so it is much more rich in terms of color than GIF was. And it also uniquely supports full transparency, and we'll get to that soon. And it's not based on LZW, it's based on LZ77 plus Huffman coding, which together, it's based on a variant of LZ77 called deflate. So we're going to talk about those things. So as with GIF, there's a lot that goes into creating a file that ends in PNG on your computer. There's a lot of different stuff, but we're going to focus on the compression part because this is the information theory class and not image processing. So the two steps that we're going to focus on are the filtering stuff and the compression stuff. So part one of ping is you take, again, your pixels to an index stream, kind of like in GIF. But ping is a little different because it can support different color channels and an opacity channel, which is called the alpha channel. So you've got your RGB palette for your red, green, and blue channel. You've also got your alpha table for your opacity. The first thing you do is you map all the possible combinations to some sort of index stream, index dictionary. And you can create rows of pixels called scan lines, and they contain up to 4 channels per pixel. you can omit opacity if you want, you can combine all the channels into one channel if you want, but there are many ways to do this, but that's a general idea. So the next step that makes pain unique is filtering. So what exactly is filtering? So filtering is kind of cool because it is one of the things, it's one of the moments where we leave sort of theoretical, not leave, where we go from like pure theory to what's happening in real life. So in real life, there's a lot of slowly varying colors, right? Like not all of our pictures are just sort of like color one, color two, color one, color two. There's often gradients, there's like ombre effects, stuff like that. So the point here is that even if there are no repeated patterns in your data, that means your data is incompressible, what you can do is you can take advantage of the slow variations and compress those. So what you do, basically you take one pixel of interest X and you look at its neighboring pixels. You can look at pixel A, which is to its left, you can look at pixel B, which is above it, and C, which is diagonal. So Ping will take every pixel value, every pixel index value, but it'll also look at how it relates to the other pixels around it, because the difference, well, depending on what filter you choose, is easier to encode. So you can do five different things. You can do none, it's very easy. Don't want to encode any differences, don't want to get any extra compression, whatever. You can do sub, which is just raw X minus raw A. So now you're looking at every pixel in relation to its leftmost pixel, or its left neighboring pixel. You could do something called up, where you look at compared to the one above it, or you could do an average. You can also do something called paid. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that correctly. It's some complicated linear function. It works well. They decided it was useful. So those are your five options. So you can do filtering. And again, since, as I mentioned, in image compression, we tend to have two-dimensional images, but we are concatenating them into one-dimensional streams. So after you encode each pixel with the difference between your filtered value, which is your prediction value, and your actual byte value, you can then filter them, and they're concatenated, and those get sent into the compressor. So part three of Ping is the actual compressor, deep plate compressor. So it was defined by Philcats in the early 1990s. I'm sorry if this is too many like historical facts. In the 1990s, it is a descendant of LZ77, and it has some specifics. As you recall, in LZ77, what you're doing is you're keeping track of what you saw before, and you have pointers to stuff that you saw before. So in this project in Deflate, they've chosen a sliding window of up to 32 kilobytes and a match length between 3 and 258 bytes. I am not sure how they came up with these numbers, but this is what makes Deflate Deflate. So in other words, it looks for matches in pixel values between 3 and 258 in length within the last 32,000-ish pixels, okay? And then after it does that, it uses a Hoffman encoder to further encode all the LZ77 stuff. So I didn't go to the details of LZ77 and Hoffman encoding because you guys know all that, but I thought it would be good to compare Ping versus JIT, right? We've now got two lossless compressors. Why do we have two? What makes them different? So here's a table from a paper or a chapter, book chapter about Ping. And what we've got is a bunch of images that are all 256 by 256 pixels, and they're all in 8-bit grayscale. So in the first column is the image name, the second column is the GIF compressed size in bytes, and then we've got the Ping compressed size and then a comparison from Ping to GIF. So let's look at Bird. Bird, it looks like GIF can compress down to like 47,000 bytes. That's not too bad. That's pretty okay. I guess it's like you save one-third in memory-ish. The original size. Ping brings it down to 32,000, so that's nice. You actually have the original size. And that's 31% better than GIF. We can do this. We are not going to do all of this. But my point is that there are actually a couple interesting examples. Remember how initially I said LZW, there are some caveats of LZW? So if you look very carefully, does anyone see something weird about this table? Here's a hint. Look in the GIF column, the GIF sizes. Anyone see something weird? These all started out as 65,536 byte images.
Some of them
are. TA doesn't count. Okay, what Shubham was saying is that, let's take a look at Bridge, the second picture. How big is the GIF file size? It's 76,000 bytes. GIF using LZW actually increased the file size. So LCW isn't always guaranteed to give you smaller file size. Ping always does, particularly when it says. Don't ask me theoretically why this is true. Talk to Zaki, I bet he would know, I hope. And yeah, so I just wanted to point that out.
If you asked me, I would give you an exercise to show that even ping can sometimes
Are there? Do you know if there are any file, any lossless compressors that guarantee smaller file size?
No, and in fact, Dimitri is Dr. made the point that no lossless compressor can have that property.
There we go. Very cool. Thanks, Simon. All right. Okay. So that's good to know. But in general, ping tends to do well. In fact, JIT typically compresses between 4:1 and 10:1. Ping will give you about 10 to 30% savings over that. So that was cool. So we saw JIT and ping. The question now is, can we do better, right? Like, if we're doing 4:1 or 10:1, that's pretty okay. Now you can store 10 images instead of, 10 instead of 1 or something. Question engineers always ask ourselves is, can we do better? The answer is yes, but only if we throw out data. So this brings us to lossy compression. So the first lossy compressor that I want to go over is JPEG. All right, so JPEG, the basics again. Because I'm a sucker for facts. It was developed, like I said, by the Joint Photographic Experts Group in 1992. It's just weird. I was 3 years old in 1992. Like, the fact that JPEG didn't exist, you know, and then 26 years later, we are able to send pictures is, I think, pretty mind-blowing. Like PNG, it was developed as an international standard, but it was developed first, partly because it was developed by a bunch of people who, you know, intentionally came together and were like, we need a standard. So, of course, it became international standard first in 1994. Unlike JIT and ping, the JPEG standard is interesting in that, like most international standards, it only specifies the codec, the coder and decoder process, and not the file format. So in JIT and ping, I believe, at least in JIT, you can, as we saw in the sort of block diagram, there are a lot of components that go into JIT, and the JIT format is specified by that. Whereas for JPEG, what they're saying is, we don't really care how you create your image as long as this coder decoder that we specify, which we'll get into the details of, can get you back an image. So this is something that you might want to keep in mind if you end up going into international standards development. It's kind of cool. But the point is that the file formats themselves are specified by EXIF and something called JPEG. So like all lossy compression algorithms, JPEG operates by tossing some information, right? Because how else are you going to get smaller than the lossless compressed? So the coolest thing, though, is that it throws out information based on assumptions about how humans perceive images. This is what I was alluding to earlier. When we move from theory to applications, there's not only stuff that we don't think about in theory, but also we can take advantage of how we look at images, how we use them in everyday life, and design compressors accordingly. So it does lossy compression actually, well, it's kind of interesting. We always say JPEG does lossy compression, but if you really break it down, I would actually say JPEG does lossy stuff and then does compression. It has two lossy steps. It does color space sampling, and it also does a discrete cosine transform. So that's where you lose information. Sorry, the discrete cosine transform, it quantizes the discrete cosine transform. That's where you lose information. So that's the lossy part. The compression part is actually just lossless off encoding. So that's why I don't really like, I don't know, it's a little misleading to me when people are like, it just does lossy compression. What it does is it does loss first, and then it compresses. So the details of that are first, let's do the loss steps first. So first we have something called color space transformation. Like I mentioned earlier, we can go from 3 channels, and I said something about like you can just have the amount of data you have and get down to 18 megabytes instead of 36 per picture. What typically happens in practice is you convert from something called red, green, blue space to something called YCBCR space. Y is luma, or how bright the pixel is. CB is a difference between the blue and lumen pixel values, and CR is a difference between red and lumen values. That in and of itself is not crazy and not lossy. What happens is that there's this thing called psychovisuals. Does anyone know what psychovisuals is? Psycho killer. Okay. It just means how humans psychologically perceive visuals. There's an entire field on this. There are people in like building 200 who work on this. So there are a lot of people studying how we perceive images, because what ultimately matters is when a human compresses an image and a human looks at a decompressed image, we want to know if that's good. So the point is that we can use, people have used psychovisual experiments to measure different parts of human perception. And what they decided was, well, it turns out that humans discriminate brightness much more than we do color. Fun fact, when it's really, really, really dark outside, we're not using our cones anymore, which are responsible for color perception. We're using only our rods. So this means that we can throw away half, that's a lot, but we can actually throw away half of our color information. We can downsample the color information, keep the brightness the same. And as humans, we really don't care about that. So that's one part of the loss. So what we're doing is we're taking, initially if you have an image that is 3 by 8 by width by height bits, right? Because if you have width bits across, height down, that's that many bits, and then 8 bits per byte, and 3 color channels, you're bringing that down to 2 by 8 by WH bits by doing color sampling. Now the next part, the next step, and this is not lossy or anything, this is just block splitting. So the next part of JPEG is it partitions each image into tiny 8 by 8 pixel blocks. And what you'll do is, of course, not every single image is precisely a multiple of 8 pixels across and down. So you can also do padding the right boundary blocks and the bottom boundary blocks. I saw this number and I was like, why 8 by 8? It turns out that it's a historical artifact. Yay, more history. So JPEG was developed in the 80s, late 80s, early 90s. And back then, most images were 720 by 575 pixels. For images of that size, you could consider smaller blocks. You consider bigger blocks. So let's think smaller. 4 by 4 pixels. What are you looking at? Those blocks were actually too small to find correlations between pixels, right? You sort of ended up with like very independent little pixels that didn't have a bearing on each other. So they're like, that's too small. This is a real Goldilocks story. And they looked at 16 by 16 blocks. But those actually contain pixels the small ones were too small to catch correlations between parts of images, and the big pixels caught too much correlation. So then they settled on an 8 by 8, which is just right. Okay, whatever. I thought that was fun. There's a really great article called JPEG at 25 if you want to learn more about JPEG. But the point is that this 8 by 8 pixel block size is actually quite flexible. These days, there's 4K TV, there's maybe even 8K TV, so we can think about actually using bigger pixel sizes because now we have higher resolution, we want more information per block. All right, so the next step is the discrete cosine transform. So this is, again, not super lossy, I would say it's the next step, but the point is that what you do is we take an 8 by 8 pixel, so on the top left here's an example of a pixel. These are all its color indices. Right, we went from the RGB to YCDCR to an index stream. And so we've got 52, 55, 61, etc. So there are 8 rows and 8 columns. First thing you do is you want to center it down to -128 to 127, because that's easier for machines. And then you do the discrete cosine transform, which is what this long wrappy arrow is. And what you're doing is you're converting from XY space to UV space. So the U dimension is in across in columns and V is down in rows. So now we've got a very different, so G is a matrix of discrete cosine transform coefficients, okay? Now, finally, the lossy part, quantization, lossy part two. So it's kind of a drag to drag around things like -415.38 as a coefficient. So the first step is often to round these coefficients using a very, very simple formula. You just take your GJK of interest and divide by this quantization matrix, which is also predetermined using psychovisual experiments, right? Like, these are all options that you could use in your algorithm when you think about how to create JPEG. These are all free parameters, but to settle on these values, they talk to a bunch of people, they try JPEG at different values, most likely. I actually don't know specifically how they did this, but I imagine this is what they did, and they ended up with this sort of matrix, which you can then ship with every single encoder and decoder, and it's standard. And what you end up with now is these quantized discrete cosine transform coefficients on the bottom right. The cool thing is that you can see that most of the bottom right, well, everything on the right and everything on the bottom, they're all zeros, right? So in a discrete cosine transform, the DC value is in the top left, which is sort of like your no frequency value. And as you go across and down, you're increasing the frequency. So intuitively, this means that we're tossing out high frequency information. why did we do that? Because again, they did a psychovisual experiment and they found that people didn't really care about high frequency variations in small areas. So they're like, okay, we can toss those. We're going to design Q this way. And that's why JPEG is JPEG. Okay, more fun facts. Discrete cosine transform is not the only transform that exists, right? In fact, the discrete wavelet transform actually, if you run JPEG but using wavelet transform instead, you actually get better results. And it avoids blocking artifacts. But the funny thing is when JPEG was developed, it was the 80s. Hardware sucked. So they went with the discrete cosine transform. They couldn't actually run the discrete wavelet transform in a good amount of time. Thought that was cool. All right. Whew. And now we are in the coding part. Again, this is not the last part. This is just the coding part. So we have our coefficient, our matrix of coefficients. First thing we do is something called run length encoding in a very special way. So like I mentioned, the matrix, these matrices don't have a whole lot of information in the right hand and the bottom, right? So what we want to do is we want to encode in the zigzag way, which captures most of the information in one section, so that most of our code words, so our code words are tuples of the run length of zeros, so the number of zeros that came before this non-zero value, and then the non-zero value itself. So if you do it in this zigzag fashion, you can capture most of the unique tuples in the first part, and then at the end it's just a bunch of zeros and you don't have to worry about those. So step two, if you do Huffman coding on that, and that's JPEG. That's it. It's like pretty straightforward. Of course, you then convert to a bitstream or a byte stream package into some sort of file format, and you send it as an email. So JPEG, as we saw, was developed in 1992. It typically achieves compression ratios between 5 to 121, so on average about 10, which is not that different from lossless, but I think on average, like something about on average, is better or more consistent. In 2000, 8 whole years later, they updated the standard and they came out with this thing called JPEG 2000, because it was the millennium. JPEG is better, so it uses the discrete wavelet transform like I mentioned. It also supports lossless compression, so that's fun. It's also just better in every way, right? There's less visible artifacts and there's less blocking. And it has, although it still has similar compression ratios to JPEG, so it didn't really improve on that. But it never made it mainstream because people just didn't care. That's sad. These days, there are some new lossy compressors, like this thing called WebP that Google developed in 2010. It achieves 25 to 30% improvement over JPEG using this thing called block prediction. So block prediction is, I would say it's similar in flavor to the prediction and filtering step in ping, because what you can do is, instead of just going directly from pixel values into discrete cosine transform, you can first convert to a smaller set of values and then do discrete cosine transform, that, et cetera. So that's one way that WebP has an advantage. And yeah, that makes it better. And the rest is more or less the same, right? You have a transform, you quantize those transform coefficients, and then you turn it into a bitstream and you decode it if you want to. So there are, of course, a lot of flaws in lossy compression, right? It's lossy, we're losing information, so by definition, it's not going to be perfect. You guys might be very familiar with some of these artifacts, like if you get a picture of a tiny snack, it might be posterized. It might have blockiness around lines, like in the word artifacts. This is typical of JPEG. But the issue is that how exactly, oh my gosh, this is not a good slide, okay. How exactly do we evaluate loss, right? If we think about it, not if we think about it, I hate that phrase. If we look back in history, it turns out that most often we've been using things called fidelity metrics, which operate pixel by pixel. So common examples are things like mean squared error, peak signal noise ratio, which is based off of mean squared error, or this thing called mean absolute error. But the point is that you're basically taking pixel X in your original image and the corresponding pixel in your new image, and you're saying, how different are these pixels? That seems pretty sound, but as I said also earlier, what really matters in image compression, right? Is it the pixels, or is it how we view the image? So, in light of that, some people, I go and drop the ball on animation. So at some point, people said, okay, we need to take human perception into account. We need to use more of the psychovisual stuff. So then they switched to trying to capture perceived visual quality. In 2004, this thing called called the structural similarity index was invented. It's a cool equation. Basically what you do is you take chunks of an image and you look at how those chunks relate to each other. And the hope is that by considering parts of the image as a whole and not just pixel by pixel, you can account for some of the higher level properties of the visual system. Intuitively, what SSIM tries, oh my gosh, what? Okay, ignore that last, I'm sorry, I don't know what was going on in that last sentence. All right, so if we look at SSIM versus MSE, so here are a bunch of images, and they all have the same mean squared error. Okay, they all have mean squared error of 210, whatever that value means. But you're human, what do you guys think? Are these images very different? Is there one in particular you prefer if your friend sent to you with limited bandwidth, whatever? Who would vote? Okay, so A is the original, top left. Who would vote for E? The center bottom one. No one wants that picture. But according to this metric, it's pretty okay. So this just highlights why there's a need for different metrics like SSIM and MSE. But the thing is that SSIM is still very high level. It doesn't directly capture human perception. So again, engineers are always like, can we do better? Yes, we can. So then they developed these things called perceptual metrics. And as you can see, they start, so this is based off of a lot of different variables and constants and stuff, and most of these constants are actually found by testing people in a lab, right? They do these psychovisual experiments, they sit people down, and they're like, do you like this image, do you like this one or that one? And then they come up with, like for instance, Q is often 2. In this bottom equation, it's a bunch of stuff raised to the Q, raised to the 1 over Q. Q is typically 2, and they got that by asking humans. So what I'm trying to say is that, oh yes, and then in 2018, Google created this thing. Oh my gosh, do we have any like Swiss German speakers? Because I don't know how to pronounce that. It's the name of a Swiss German cookie. Gutzli, maybe, whatever. It's based on, oh wait, is Butcher Ugly like cookie or is Gutzli? I think they're both Swiss German words. Google's weird. Anyway, in 2018, they're like, you know, a lot of people in the image compression community recognize that this is an issue. So they're starting to develop new compressors, and in 2018, this compressor came out that is based on, quote, a metric that estimates a psychovisual similarity of two images. I went to the GitHub page, they're very opaque. I can't figure out what psychovisual is here, but the point is people are trying. Including some people at Stanford. So, last part of the talk, this is the last part, thank you for hanging in with me, is this thing called human compression. Spoiler alert, I worked on this, Shuwon did as well, and we worked on it with a bunch of high schoolers. The question here was, can we design a better compression algorithm by directly asking humans what they care about? And can we do some clever things, like using humans not only as describers and reconstructors to do the compression, can we also make use of all the information available on the internet? And can we directly, instead of resorting to things like SSIM, which are pretty okay, or much worse, like PSNR, can we actually directly ask humans what they think of our compression techniques, and as a result, try to improve our algorithm more? So the components of the lossy human compression paradigm are two humans, plus Photoshop, plus Skype, plus Google Images. The point is that you have one person who's called the describer, and they use text-based instructions to describe a selected image. So for instance, you know, if I had a photograph of this lecture hall, right, there are many ways to encode that information. I could say, in pixel 0 to 56, there is a gray pixel, and then in the next pixel, there is a green one for the chair, et cetera, et cetera. That's how computers do it. How would a computer do it? How would a human do it? I'm a human, so what I would say is, it is a lecture hall. Lecture hall is meaningful to me. There are rows of green chairs, there are white columns, and there are gray walls and green carpeting. Think about how much information is conveyed in those short sentences. So the question is, the task is for the describer to use text-based commands, because we know as humans we can process this information and convey information a lot more efficiently. So the describer conveys information, right? He describes an image of his choice. A reconstructor then attempts to recreate the image using photo manipulation software. Yes, we are basically doing like bad Photoshop. Well, not bad. We're doing Photoshop. If you guys ever go on like Reddit bad Photoshop, it's pretty funny. Here's a more detailed setup of what this entire thing looks like. Okay, so what we do is we have a describer, and they have an original image in mind. And when I say original, this is very important. Because we are leveraging other information on the web, we want it to be completely original. So over the summer, we had three high school students. One of them happened to go on safari, and he took a bunch of pictures. In theory, you could find a picture of two giraffes in a safari in Africa online, but none of them are going to be exactly the one that this guy took, right? So he has that one. He sets up a Skype call with the reconstructor. The Skype call is very specific. The describer can see what the reconstructor is doing on their screen. The reconstructor can see text commands, or actually he can hear and see text commands. He can only read text commands. Thank you. He can only read text commands from the describer. The describer can hear the reconstructor, he can see the reconstructor, but the reconstructor only gets text, okay? And the reason why he only gets text will become important soon. So basically the reconstructor opens up Photoshop, and based on what the describer sends over, starts reconstructing the image. Now, what does the describer send over? He can send over links to public images. He can send over commands for transformations. So that's what these images show. So for instance, you'll send over like links to giraffes, links to shrubs, links to grass. And then he can see the reconstructor composite all these things together on Photoshop. Can you guys read this? I'll read it out loud. So this is an example of what it looks like. So the Skype chat expert is all the text commands that the describer sends. And you can imagine that what's on the left is what the describer sees on the reconstructor's computer. So first he sends a link. Here's a link to grass. Okay, next command. Try transformations. Elongate the fence. I don't know what he's talking about. Fence. Okay, whatever. Only focus on the vertical. That's important, right? He doesn't want, you don't want to increase while maintaining aspect ratio. He wants it to look like there's more grass. Next up, there's a line of shrubbery that goes across. Send a link to shrubbery. Make sure to do this, blah, blah, blah. And then he even specifies things like the line itself starts about a quarter from the left. Okay, this is cool. Like, we can use text to encode all this information, which would otherwise kind of be laborious to use to convey in the computer. They continue. Now he sends links to giraffes. And it's kind of funny to see what's going on. So first off, he misspelled giraffe at some point. It's drag. And then he says, like, make the right one bigger than the left, make that level, wait back, put it back. And I point these things out to show that, like, the human communication here isn't perfect, but, it's a record. And again, we'll come back to the record. So basically, this proceeds until the describer is like, that's good enough, I'm done, I'm tired, I'm hungry. No, in theory, it would be just, it's good enough. So that's the final reconstruction on top, the yellowish looking one, and the original image is in the bottom. And what do you guys think? It's okay. It's not the best Photoshop ever. As of now, our goal is not to win Photoshop awards. The goal is to see how much information it takes to convey an image. So we're not quite at a compressed representation yet. So the text chat that I was talking about, that is going to be the basis of our compressed representation, right? As you recall, the general compression paradigm is you have an original bitmap, you have a compressed bitstream, and then you can get a reconstruction. So in this case, we have our original image, the reconstructor is automatically creating the reconstruction, and the only information you need to create that reconstruction, that's the text transcript. So that's our analog to the traditional compression paradigm. So as I said, the describer keeps describing until he's satisfied, and at some point, he's like, stop. They remove timestamps because that's not vital to the communication. And then the transcript, they also remove some superfluous stuff. If you want to be super careful, I don't know. We could do more, but for now, like for the purposes of this first experiment, you just remove timestamps. Then the transcript is further compressed using VZIP2. And this is legal because, as we saw, in many cases we went from colors to indexes to bits to bytes, right? So yes, we contain a lot of information in text, but we can further compress that text because, we would just throw on Huffman encoders and JPEG and in ping. So that's the analog there. And then what we do is we want to see how good our reconstruction is, how much information we've conveyed in our text compared to how much information we convey on a computer. So then we use WebP, that compression algorithm I showed. We use that to generate a compressed image of similar size as a compressed text transcript. Okay? And that's because, like I said, our compressed text transcript transcript is basically a bitstream representation in some sense. So this is what the text transcript would look like. It's a bunch of instructions. And then you can see that it's 5 kilobytes of plain text. And that's our transcript. All right, so let's do some evaluation. Like I said, we wanted to make sure the evaluation was human-based. That was the whole point of the experiment. We wanted to move away from things like pixel by pixel loss. So what we did was we used humans on Amazon Turk. We did large-scale surveys. So for each image, we display the visual image and the human reconstruction and ask the workers to rate their satisfaction on a discrete scale from 1 to 10. We used, as you might notice, we used very, very vague language. We said, what is your general satisfaction? Because we don't know what humans care about yet, and we didn't want to limit them to one particular axis or aspect of comparison. So we then did identical experiments with web reconstruction, and we collected 100 survey responses for each set and each image. And just so you guys get a good idea of what this looks like, this is what a worker would see. So original image on the left, some reconstruction, in this case it's our human one, and on the bottom are 10 rating buttons saying level of satisfaction. Very simple. These are preliminary results. We had 13 images in total, ranging from 1 megabyte to 5-ish megabytes. And we can see the compressed, so first off, let's look at the compressed chat size, right? Like what we've conveyed in words compressed. That only takes 3 kilobytes. So that's, you know, we're in general talking about in like 3 orders of magnitude smaller, which is pretty cool. If you guys remember, JPEG, PNG, GIF, we'd only get to about like 10 or 21-ish. That's what's so exciting. The WebP size is similar because that was our goal. And let's look at the scores. So the mean scores are reported in median scores. Let's focus on the mean. So there's the human scores on the left and the WebP scores on the right here. It's hard to see, but the bold ones are where humans outperform WebP. That is, okay, so for instance, one robot sketch. Humans, over 100 human tests, they ranked it an average of 8.25. WebP only got 3.46. So that's pretty exciting, right? We're starting to see, like, you see these results are telling us, can humans do better? Yes, they can. So I thought it would be fun to show you guys some examples. So we saw the giraffe one. This is just a little closer. Yeah, what do you guys think? Like, would you, assuming you only had 3 kilobytes, would you send a friend the human reconstruction, or would you send them the WebP? Show of hands for WebP. Ooh, show of hands for human. Okay, nice. This was an interesting image. Okay, so this is the Palo Alto Cow Train Station. And this is fun. So what we're seeing is that the humans got a score of 10, on average, 7 out of 10. WebP got only 3 out of 10. And it's interesting because this is an image that, this is a case where actually we have, the images are pretty common online, right? Like you can type in California Caltrain, you can probably get a Google image of a Caltrain. If you want to be super picky, and these boys weren't, but you could even make sure the Caltrain number matches. In the original photo, it's train 118. They didn't bother changing it on the human reconstruction, but you could do that. Whereas if you look at WebP, everything is blurred out of recognition. So this is a case where you can use the public set of images to get really close to what you want. Another example is national landmarks, like the Eiffel Tower. Everyone, there are a million pictures of the Eiffel Tower online. WebP, so in this case, humans and WebP were ranked similarly, probably because there wasn't a whole lot of detail in this image to begin with. It's just the tower and then like a boat and a bridge, and if you blur parts of the bridge, no one really cares. This is a fire. I was really impressed with the human one here. I thought it was a really good example of Photoshop. Some balloons. So let's get to this one. So on this one, humans scored a measly 3 out of 10. WebP got 6 out of 10. So you know, if I ask you guys why, you'd probably just be like, it's not the same person, right? Like it's very obvious to us humans, it is not the same person. So this is a great example of A, when you don't have a Palo Alto high schooler's images plastered all over Google, it's really hard to reconstruct their face. This is something that a human compression algorithm would have to could work on. But B, it's interesting to see that like through the variety of images we use, we can see cases where a paradigm like ours would work well and where it wouldn't work well. When it comes to things that humans care deeply about, and this goes by just like visuals, like who a human is and what makes a face a face, it's really hard to do that well. So some takeaways from human compression. At the moment, it's not a practical compression scheme, right? Because we're employing humans who not only get tired and bored and aren't all experts at Photoshop and require money. The thing I mentioned earlier is that the crux of compression algorithms is that they need to be 100% reproducible, right? Like if you compress an image once, you want to be able to get the same result the second time. We're humans, we have a lot of randomness built into us and we can't do that yet. So, you know, despite that, we still show that humans such a compression where we relied on humans to pick out the details of what mattered could do pretty well. We also learned that using semantically and structurally similar images, so semantics here is again like picking out details instead of caring about very nitpicky pixel level details that may not be important, can dramatically improve compression ratio. I think you know we saw about a 10 to 100 fold improvement on typical compression. And we also showed, most importantly, that you can use publicly available images to create a new lossy compression framework. This might seem iffy to some people, but given how many images are publicly available these days, it is not impossible that you can recreate almost any sort of landscape image. The honest truth is that most of us will probably have our pictures, some kind of picture, on Google. Like, I'm on Google because I have to have some sort of public-facing image. So, that's the future. So we're hoping that the future of human compression will be similar. We're not the only ones thinking about this. If you go to wave.one, they're a new compression algorithm company that's very secretive about how they do the lossy compression, but if you look at the web page, it's a very similar premise, right? Like, they're like, how would you describe an image? That's not how computers describe images, and that's not how we compress. And the results are pretty cool, so I recommend you check them out. For us, you know, our future is, first off, even though we use natural language as an example where you can convey a lot of information, you're not necessarily married to that. We know that these days, especially if you want a practical, reproducible algorithm, we have to rely on machines. And so there's really no reason to stick with natural language. If instead you used, say, GANs that could both describe and reconstruct images at the same time, you would rely on some other representation like pointers to public data set images or a shared data set. And then this is kind of meta and I think it's funny, but you know, even though human scores were very important, you could even outsource that to machines, but you could do it better. You could do it in a more humanoid way. So you could use neural networks to predict human scores. So maybe we wouldn't even have to use Amazon mechanical term. And of course, the biggest thing is that we are leveraging this concept in information theory that we call side information, which some people, we've talked to some psychologists, they're like, well, that's cheating. And it really isn't. And here's a really good example. Who likes watching crime TV drama shows? Yeah, so like, there's always like a sketch artist, right? Like, who's the perp? What does he look like? What color in his eyes and what shape in his face? We talked to a sketch artist, and it turns out that sketch artists, you know, some very talented ones can sit down and draw on the fly, but most of them actually have a handbook. They're at some point, the FBI published a handbook of images where it's like, these are all the eye shapes, these are all the face shapes, these are all the hair colors, and what you do is you have a witness come in and you point. You know, you say that the perp had almond eyes, curly hair, and a round face. No, triangular shaped face. And then the sketch artist's job is to composite all that together. So, again, we're just trying to draw inspiration from humans, and so that's what we mean when we say that humans are awesome compressors. All right, thanks a lot for your attention. That was a lot of information. Happy to answer any questions. Yes?
If we limit to the source image to the data, is there any theoretical limit of the conversion rate or?
So the question is, if you limit your original image to the bitmap, is there a theoretical limit to how well you could possibly do?
Well, theory to describe the limit of the conversion rate.
So, of course, it depends on what compression algorithm you use, but I guess you're just asking for like two-dimensional in general.
Yeah, general thing, like a channel limit. Something like
not that I'm
think you can, as we know, like the rate distortion function pertains to a certain source that characterizes the distribution of the data. So there are two-dimensional sources that stipulate the data is coming from this sort of a Gaussian field, and then you can characterize the rate distortion function there. But of course, in practice, it's never the case that people agree that a certain probabilistic source is a good model for your data. So there's never really fundamental limit. It's always about, oh, maybe there's a better model, better way of doing things. And that's why we believe there's a lot of potential for improvement.
So there's no clear method to describe, or no concrete method.
No, not the moment. And I think maybe a good analog would even like estimate the entropy of the language, right? Because there's no clear source. We just sort of made up language as humans, but you can still estimate the entropy of it by doing human experiments.
Thank you.
Yeah. Any other questions? Oh, yes.
Have there been any attempts to like mechanize this process and like actually turn the human data into it?
Great question. So within our group, there is a lot of room. If you personally are interested in helping us translate from our initial experiments to something that is actually implementable, you can chat with us. As far as the industry, I think Wave 1 is a good example. Beyond that, I'm not too sure.
So we got hints now in the compression workshop that Google, largely inspired by this work, are working on something.
Well, also
but still, there's room for us to do things, so please join us.